Fusion in a sense, like we have different dance styles dancing together on one platform. Of course, that has happened. Like Bharatnatyam is also there, Odissi is also there, and Satriya is also there. That has happened, definitely. But in terms of the way you see the contemporary dance, so that kind of work hasn't been done yet. It depends on how you understand that entire, like, you know, for example, if I take a concept and frame it accordingly without harming the philosophy of the tradition, I don't think so it should harm it. But of course, if it's digress, personally, I wouldn't like to take up an assignment that digresses from the philosophy of Satriya. Because, yeah, of course, that's always an individual choice. But yeah, personally, I wouldn't like to do that. I would always like to stick to the philosophy. Yeah. One of my friends, she's a Kuchipudi dancer, Sri Lakshmi. So both of us, we worked on a production called Taraka, and where she was doing the role of Taraka, and I was doing the role of Rama. So at that time, it's like more, the concentration was more on the concept rather than the form. Yeah. So later on, I would love to do something that, like, you know, takes up a particular concept and where I use dance as a kind of language rather than representing something called Satriya as such. But the moment I introduce the world as something called Satriya, I'd like to do something that's, you know, handed down to me. And of course, with new perspective, I would like to go back to each and every composition with whatever new understanding I could give to it. Right now, again, as I said, we have the world haven't seen this dance style. If I start my journey with Satya with a lot of experimentations, people would be like, you know, okay, what exactly is the repertoire of Satriya? You know, is this like, you know, choreography, or is it the tradition itself? There will be a whole lot of questions. So right now I feel it's very important that people should understand the tradition and what exactly the tradition looks like, at least the repertoire. So like in Bharatnatyam, everyone knows that Alarippu, Jatiswaram, Sabdam, Varnam, Tillana. What in Satriya? So in Satriya we start with Ramdani. Ramdani is a pure dance number. That is followed by Gitarnach. Gitarnach is you know, we elaborate a Geet. So it's an Nritya component. And then we end with Melanach. Melanach is like, you know, in, again, a Nritya presentation. It's something like Tillana. So as I said to you, Girija, that the entire repertoire is divided into male and female numbers. So when we do an like 1.5 hour program or two hours performance, we divide our presentation into male numbers and female numbers. So we start our presentation with Ramdani followed by Gitarnach, Melanach, then we change our costume. I mean, we move on to the Prakriti aspect. Again, it starts with Ramdani, Gitarnach and Melanach. So in between, we also have Borgits, you know, that will be another Gitarnach. So, but like, you know, Padam kind of compositions where it's only Abhinaya. In Satriya, we have a whole lot of, it's because it's an oral tradition. There are no written documentation of this art form. Yes. So it's always in the memory that this entire dance has, you know, journeyed. So we have local terminologies for the mudras, for the hastas, for the footwork. So everything, we have local names instead of Shastric terminologies. So Pataka is known as Dhvaj. Of course, it means the same, but Tripataka is known as Fort. So, like, you know, we have local terminologies for that. In a way, individual documentations are going on, and also we have Satriya Kendra. It's a kind of center of Sangeet Natak Academy, which we have in Guwahati. They have been doing few documentations. And even in Sangeet Natak Academy, years back, they have documented, they have traveled to different satras. So they have documented the tradition, you know, the art forms. But I personally feel we need whole lot of things to document more and more, and the saddest part is that some of the greatest maestros have already passed away. Yeah, and as I said, because it's oral tradition, you know, once some ragas are gone, it's already gone. Yeah. And you don't, and if the master, like, you know, Of course, he has been training his disciples, but you know, if it's gone, it's gone. We need to document that kind of art forms also, and also whole range of art forms we have in Assam, which is not at all known. Even in Assam, like, you know, from one part to another, people haven't heard about that, because it remains within a village or within a particular community. So I personally feel that we have a whole lot of things to document. And Assam is again a place where we have a range of you know, ethnic communities residing there. So each and every ethnic community, they have their own performative expressions. So right starting from costume to music, dance, instruments, range of, like, you know, performative expressions. So it's very important, and as I said, it's orally, like, you know, handed down. It's very important to document that, and it's documentation, not only, like, you know, just to document and archive it, but at the same time that helps as a researcher also, you know, to work on that particular tradition, to work on particular art form. My topic is traditions of performing arts in Assam and the role of satras. So when I was like, oh my God, it's like a huge list of performances, and of course from that I had to, you know, program it accordingly. But I was like, you know, awed by the, you know, vocabulary of performances actually. And being in Assam itself, I didn't know so much about it. The PhD itself opened a whole lot of things, and yeah, it would be lucky if Shastram would, like, you know, document such forms.